If you've never seen a fully completed project in Airtable that went from data schema all the way to automations and interfaces, you are in the right place. In this video, I am breaking down our second part of the content production process that we utilize here at Gap Consulting. This is the exact Airtable database that we use to go from start to finish on any piece of content that we produce here on YouTube. The best part is our team is able to work on their own unique parts of the process and collaborate in one place. So if you want to see a live example of this in action, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I own Gap Consulting, and we make it our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools. Of course, Airtable is one of the leading no-code tools in this space, and I'm excited to be talking about the solution that we have built internally. Now, bear in mind before we get going that this is part two of a two-part series. So in the first element of this particular series, I broke down the structure in Airtable and I shared with you all of the different parts here on my screen that are going to be the different elements that play here into the final output, which is getting a piece of content from planning all the way down to published on YouTube, on our blog, etc. In this particular video, we're going to be going deep on the automations and in the interface elements of Airtable. Let's kick things off by breaking into the automations panel now that we understand the data schema from part one, and let's just go by these automations one at a time. Now, the first one here is scheduling a social media post. So inside of this, we have a trigger inside of our view. So in our view, what we've done is we've said, only bring something into this view when it matches a specific time. So if it is the current time to publish this piece of social media, so let's say, for example, we scheduled the social media to be sent out on March 10th at 10 a.m. Well, at March 10th at 10 a.m., that piece, that social media post is going to come into view on that view. That will trigger the automation. And then we're running a script that we're sending to Make, and Make is going to pick up this information and know what record that was. It's going to go back into Airtable, find the record, and then it will push that out to all of our different pieces of social media. So on LinkedIn, on Facebook, etc. So all of this is handled directly from this social media scheduler right here inside of our automations. Of course, the other part of that lives in make.com. Another exciting automation here is the publication process. This is where we have to create all the different records inside of our planning module there. So we say, hey, once a piece of content is in the publishing in process phase, at that point, we need to create all of the different items on the checklist so that we can make sure that it is completed from publishing to complete. So we're moving from the stage of publishing right here all the way to complete in order to cross over in from review into complete. Of course, we need to go through this checklist. And so on this checklist, we're going to create all of the different tasks associated with that particular information on that particular piece of content. The person assigned is going to be our publisher here, and they're going to get a due date for that. And then, of course, we have a particular part of the process, whether that's our internal blog or our YouTube. In either case, it's all getting added right here. We also have the scheduling of social media posts. This is going to happen from an interface, as you'll see in a moment. Inside of our interface, a simple button just needs to be clicked, and that will automatically create a new social media post on behalf of that piece of content. We also have an opportunity here for an automation where we are drafting the social media post. And the fun part about this is it's again talking with make.com. This is through the script here. And what's happening is when it is in the social media schedule, we are automatically asking OpenAI, ChatGPT, to write that social media post for us. I'm going to demo this live in the interface, so you'll see this automation in action. But what's happening here is when it is bringing into the social media schedule, at that point, it will then run this script, talk to make.com, and make.com is going to talk to ChatGPT and automatically create the content for that social media post, which is saving us a lot of time, meaning we don't have to plan that out ourselves, and we simply have to review it before we go to publish that social media. Now, we also have Slack messaging, and so this is where a lot of alerts are happening. When certain things happen inside of the different database elements, I want to receive notification in Slack so that I know to do my job. So for example, I'll message myself with an automation that says, hey, a new video is complete and ready for review, and then I'm bringing in a particular link so that I can just access that link, click it in Slack, it's going to automatically open up my interface, and then I don't have to worry about hunting it down, and I can get right to work and approve that particular part in the process. As you can see, there are several other automations here as well. The last one that I really want to draw our attention to has to do with creating Google Drive folders. And so here we are again running that script, sending information to Make so that we can automatically create Google Drive folders for a new piece of content. So when a content meets these different specifications, specifically that the stage is in recording phase and some other things, meaning that we haven't already created new Google Drive folders, that we have already assigned a scheduling date and that we have a title for the video, if those conditions are met, we're going to go out and talk to Google Drive thanks to our integration with make.com right here. And all of these automations are being triggered directly from our Airtable base, as you see right here. So obviously a lot of automations going on in the background, but now let's turn it over and look at the interfaces that we have created. Now the first phase in the interface process has to do with the editing team. And so going into the editing interface, it's simply a calendar at the beginning. But once inside the calendar, we've granted permission to our team that has access to this particular editorial calendar that they can drill in and actually access different elements inside of these pieces of content. So if I were, for example, publishing something here, syncing with other apps from Smart Suite, this is currently scheduled for February 22nd. Well, my editors can now click into that particular element and access all of the relevant information. Now, I also want to point out that they cannot edit everything, and that's because some things we don't want to make editable and some things we do want to make editable. So, in the example here, we can't actually change the scheduled date. The only person who has permission to do that is me, myself, and I'm not going to do that in the interface, actually. I will do that directly in the database. But you'll notice that everyone who has access can edit the name or the title of this particular piece of content. We can leave notes for each other here. So I can just put in some example notes. Notice that rich text is enabled, so I can easily come in and make that bold if I want to, or add some bullet points, etc. I can also choose what brand this is. So is this the Gap Consulting brand? Is this our Built to Scale brand? Who are we representing here? What stage is this in? And of course, once the editor has produced a version that they're looking to get reviewed, they can include the frame.io right here, and then I can go in and access this and review this particular piece. So let's take a moment and imagine that for this particular piece of content, we have actually moved it into the recording phase. As soon as I do this, we're going to take a moment and notice the automation is going to create those Google Drive URLs. These buttons are currently not clickable, and just like that, you see that now they are. So once I'm done recording, I'll just open this button up and drop those particular files right in here, and the team can now collaborate succinctly in one space. Once the editing is complete, the editors can come back, click on Final File, open up a different Google Drive folder still related to this piece of content, drop the final file in here, and their job is now done. Now all they have to do is smash on Ready for Review, and what we're going to notice is that the stage gets automatically updated to be editing in review. Now I'm also sharing my Slack here, which is going to show us that I just received a Slack message to myself per the automations I was talking about that says, hey Gareth, it's time to check this out. This particular piece of content is ready for review. Can it get moved up, or are we needing to send that back for more things? So right inside of Slack, I can click on that and it's gonna open up that particular record and I can come in and say, yes, this is great. Let's move it on to the next stage in the process. So let's continue with our example here, remembering that we are looking at the sync with other apps from Smart Suite piece of content. Let's go back into interfaces now and pick up where that one left off. Now we're in the publishing process. So what's gonna happen? Well, now here inside the publishing interface, I can only see those elements here, those pieces of content that are currently in the right part of the process. They've already gone through the editing stage and they are now ready to be published. And so in order to really demo this, I'm going to first have to impersonate not myself, but Eric, who also has access to this particular interface. When I look at Eric's perspective and I go to the production process, we're going to see that we have all these different elements on the checklist that are due for Eric. And the only reason that I have to impersonate Eric is because I've set this to say you can only see those types of things that have been assigned to you. That way we don't get bogged down by a lot of other tasks that other people have to complete. So if I'm not looking at Eric's view and I'm instead viewing this as myself, then none of these elements are going to show up here because they're not on my to-do list. So this is a great way, again, to stay really organized inside of an interface and make sure that you're only seeing relevant data to you for your specific part of the process. So let's go back to the published version of this. Here I am in the content elements. You'll notice that certain things are not filled out. And of course, we can chat about this and collaborate directly inside of the interface itself. Different files have to be uploaded here, a YouTube thumbnail here, a blog image here, and then an SRT file for closed captions. We want to drop in things like the blog page, the YouTube link, etc. Moving on, we had the production process, and this is where we saw the checklist that Eric is going to have assigned to him for all the different elements on the parts of the process that need to be included. Once that's good to go, I'll receive notification when everything gets checked off. And then this will be moved into the publication process. So to access this, we have to go back to the actual data itself because I'm not Eric and I can't actually represent him on his behalf. So I have to go back to the raw data, and normally this would all be tackled in the interface from Eric. But for the sake of this example, I'll come in and automatically check off all of these different elements for this piece of content. So once these elements are checked off, that's then going to move it into the next stage, so I can flip into my interface now. And of course, I would also receive a Slack message just as I did earlier. And if I go into the publication process and I look at the review, now we have this record here inside the review process. So you'll see that I can look at it and see here's the YouTube link. Production is 100% complete because I just checked off all those boxes. What is the blog page, the blog title? This would all be filled out, and I would be able to go and review all these things and have a conversation here if I needed any clarity or if I needed to ask for anything to be redone. Now, assuming that it's all good and we're happy to move forward, all I have to do is hit a button inside of my interface, which marks it as complete, and it's now removed from this view. Now it's in the final stage and it's published content. So we can flip on over to published content. Of course, it's missing some elements, so they're not showing up here, but this is what an actual completed piece of content looks like. Here's the actual thumbnail, here's the blog link, and we can go ahead and schedule social media posts directly from here. So this is where things get next level cool. Now that we've already published the content and it's live, all I have to do now is actually push a button to schedule social media posts around that content. So let's say I wanted to put out a social media post about 4 red flags to avoid in working as a no-code consultant. All I have to do is push a button. Literally that easy. That social media post now exists. In order to access the next part of it, I have to go to the social media calendar, and I'm gonna see an unscheduled piece of content over here on the side. So let's say I wanna schedule that particular client red flags to avoid. I can just drag it, drop it on over here, and it's now added to my calendar. I can drill in and say, this one's gonna go off at 7 a.m. on 1/24. It's that easy. That piece of content is now scheduled. But you probably ask, what the heck are we talking about? What's the social media post going to be? Well, in order to see that, we can go to the upcoming social media posts. And you'll notice that on these upcoming social media posts, they are automatically coming in with social comments. And that is because of the fact that we have that OpenAI integration that I mentioned through automation. So this is getting created for us. The whole social comment is created from OpenAI, and all we have to do is review it. So let's go find that one that we just scheduled up to be set up for the upcoming day. So I believe it was here for 1/24. Here it is. You'll notice that this is the one we just created to be sent out at 7 a.m. on tomorrow, a day after the day of this recording. And here is that piece of content. We have to just review a little piece, make sure it looks right. Are you considering hiring a no-code consultant? Check out these 4 red flags to avoid. You don't want to end up with a bad experience. Okay, that's okay, but actually this particular piece of content is supposed to be from the perspective of the consultant. So we should change it up just a little bit. And this is where OpenAI isn't 100% perfect. And so of course we wanna have that review phase. So I would wanna change this and say, are you talking with prospective clients? And there we go, I'm happy with that. So not all the time do we have to edit it. Most of the time, 95% of the time, it comes in great. But there is that 5% of the time that we want to give it a double check and make sure we're good. So now you'll see that this is scheduled. It's all good to go and ready to roll. And so the final part here inside of the interface is for Eric to also access the newsletter. These are the upcoming pieces of content that haven't yet gone out on a particular newsletter. So he'll be able to find them here and say, ah, yeah, we actually should have included that on that newsletter. And so in the future, we can always go back and see, what is the piece of content that we referred to on the newsletter that went out on January 23rd? It's all tracked right here. Once it's done, he marks it as published. The end. Now, I know I went into great detail here, but my purpose was to show you how this entire process can work from start to finish. The best part about this was all fully customized for our particular workflow. Your workflow is very likely different in one or more areas. So customize your Airtable experience to reflect what you need. I know I went fast in this video, so if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to drop them below. And of course, if you want to watch more content like this about the amazing opportunities available inside of No Code, then please consider subscribing to this video. That's it for this one. I look forward to seeing you in the next one.